was that your idea to put that on the practice jerseys? Because Doug said it's a constant reminder for us. So whatever it was intended for, it's working.
Well, we'll see if it's working or not at the end of this season. But you know, they need to understand that's a real number, and it impacts our ability to be successful. And it's something that that we've set our sights on to try to improve. And hopefully, that constant reminder, if it helps a little bit, then it's worth it.
Coach, talk about the hype. Are you guys worried about the hype effect in this team?
Certainly there's some concern because these guys are going through it for the first time. But, you know, expectations, I think, are a good thing. It usually means you have pretty good players. And I think we have good players. So I think these guys are just anxious to get away from me on the practice floor and get games to begin. But we still have a lot of work to do. There's a lot of room for growth in this team. And if we can continue to work hard the next few weeks, I think we'll be ready when November 9th rolls around.
Greg, do you feel like you might have fueled the hype a little bit by setting the Sweet 16 out there?
Well, if somebody asked me what my goal is, I'm not going to lie to them. I mean, that's my goal. But that was my goal last year, too. So I think anybody, if they're going to be honest, that's what their goals are. So I don't think there's anything wrong with putting that out there. And I think our team's expectations are probably very similar to that. So we're certainly not going to hide from it, but at the same time, we understand there's a target on our back. We've got a lot of work to do between now and then if we expect to have an opportunity to have that happen. But that's what our goal is.
Of the teams that you've coached in your career, I mean, you've got nine of your top 10 guys back this year. Is this about as good as a coach could feel about what he has going into a season, given the experience that you have?
I think most coaches always feel good before the season starts, and then they get about 8 practices in, and then they don't feel so good. And I think I fit right into that category. It's just nothing ever goes as quickly and as smoothly as you would like to when you dive into it again, and people are maybe relearning some techniques. You got some new guys you're trying to get acclimated, and we're breaking in a new point guard. So anytime you do that, I think there's some bumps in the road, and that's certainly been the case with us in the early going. But we're moving the right direction, and as long as we continue to get a little bit better every day, that's what we're shooting for.
How tough is it to replace a guy like Antoine that was there and was a leader for so long?
No, it's difficult. That game experience and understanding what to do in certain situations, part of that you only learn by doing it and being out there under the lights when the pressure is on. And we don't have anybody that's experienced that before. And Austin got a taste of it last year, and I think certainly that has helped him. But it's definitely an area of concern for us because I think at the other positions we have a pretty good idea of what we're going to get and what we should expect. I think the point guard position there's going to be some peaks and valleys there, especially early in the season. It's something that we're just going to have to help these guys get through.
When you start practice, you have a few under your belt. You said some bumps in the road. Is there some attitude adjustments that need to be had, or what's been your take a weekend?
Well, I don't think any athlete's that excited about practicing twice a day for a couple hours. So you have to get them refocused and make sure they understand that we've got to play this possession like a game depends on it. And it's hard to get people to approach that, especially when you've got an older team that's been through this before. And maybe there's a sense of boredom having to go through the same drills over and over again. But there's a reason for that. And we're trying to develop habits, and we're moving that direction. But we're certainly not there yet.
You don't get a sense that they are buying into the hype or anything like that, or a sense of entitlement or anything?
No, I don't think so. I think they're smart enough and mature enough. And they dealt with a lot last year. We were first ranked late in November and really were in the rankings almost the entire season. So it's not like this team hasn't dealt with a target on its back before, at least a large portion of these guys. So I think they understand it. I think they get it. I think they understand that you just take that for what it is. It doesn't really mean anything, and you can't allow it to take you away from the job that you have to do.
What are you expecting from the Valley this year?
I think it'll be good. I think there's a lot of good players coming back. I think some teams return a significant portion of their roster, certainly Northern Iowa and Illinois State, I think are very talented. Wichita State, even though they've lost quite a bit, have had a great recruiting class and have had some guys sitting out that I think can have an impact right away. And I think some of the teams in the bottom are going to be better. I think Bradley will be improved. I think Evansville will be good again. I think Drake with Seth Van Dees coming back will be a better basketball team than they were a year ago. So you know, once again, I expect it to be a dogfight, and you know, hopefully we're one of the teams in that fight.
There's a handful of your guys are on Twitter, and you are on Twitter. There's a coach down the street that coaches football in Nebraska who don't allow his guys to tweet during the year. Where do you fall on that?
Well, we watch it, you know, and we educate our guys on what to do and what not to do. And, you know, I've only got 15 of them to watch, so it's a little easier for me than trying to watch 110. And I might feel the same if I was in his situation.
Sure.
So, but, you know, I think there's a level of trust that our coaching staff has with our guys, and they understand that we'll provide some rope as long as they don't take advantage of it and venture down a path that is unacceptable. And then when that happens, then of course the rules have to change and the level of trust changes. So far so good, and I expect that to continue.
Hey Greg, is it pretty hard to count on your guys scoring and shooting at the level that they did a year ago?
Well, that's why I think we have to defend better, because I don't think you can expect that. You know, our three-point numbers were off the charts last year. Our field goal percentage was off the charts. Now, I'd like to think we're going to be a good shooting team, and I say that because I think we have good shooters, and I think we understand you have to take good shots. And I think for the most part, teams that take good shots are going to shoot a relatively good percentage, and we're going to start our offense inside out like we always do, getting the ball into to Greg and Doug and start our offense there. And as a result of that, I think we get some pretty open three-point shots. So, you know, can we do it again? I sure hope so. But if not, I'd like to think our defense will be a little bit better and can carry us when we don't.
You were talking about Avery's improvement on defense. Give me a specific where you've seen that kind of improvement from him.
Well, I think it's across the board. His footwork's better. His technique's better. His endurance and his ability to make multiple plays on one possession, which is the key to any defense, is there with Avery this season that necessarily wasn't there a year ago. So Avery's made great strides. He's always been a good offensive player and a very talented offensive player. But he's bought in what we've asked him to do defensively. And, you know, we're going to need a stopper on the perimeter. And at least so far in the early going, if I had to name that person today, it'd be Avery Dingman.
What other programs nationally, what other mid-major programs or models for you, what you're trying to create here?
Well, I think you look at Gonzaga, I think you look at Xavier, certainly what Butler, the run they had a few years ago. But you'd like to hope that when Gonzaga and Xavier so much credit, that they've been successful, but they've been able to sustain it. There hasn't been any fall off whatsoever, and obviously their investment in basketball at those two institutions is off the charts, much like it is here. You know, we play in a beautiful building. We've got a great fan base. We're about to break ground here in a few months on a new practice facility. So all the things are in place, and now you just have to sustain success. And I think when you do that, you enter that conversation of schools like Gonzaga, Xavier, and Butler.
How do you get to that point? What is it you're doing right now?
Well, consistency is one, but I also think one thing that we don't have that all those schools have is they've had an appearance in the Sweet 16 or beyond. When you get to that second weekend in the NCAA tournament, things change. I think your story is told. I think you become much more known nationally when that happens, because you're down to just a few games that second weekend, and they have to have something to talk about. So they tell your story, and you know we've fallen short of that on several opportunities, and you know I hope sooner or later we'll kick that door down.